role, the voice behind such hits as These Eyes Stand Tall and, of course, American Woman. American Woman! Was the single biggest hit ever for the group The Guess Who. They broke up back in the mid-80s, reunited this past summer in Winnipeg, their hometown, for the Pan Am Games. Burton Cummings and his music is next. He secretly wanted to be an NHL goalie, but there was this tug and pull toward the world of music, and we're glad that that tug won because it gave us Burton Cummings, one of the great voices in Canadian rock. He started out with a variety of little bands, of course went on to be part of the Guess Who, and then again to a single career. The group broke up and reunited this past summer at the Pan Am Games, but Burton Cummings has never stopped making music. What's the longest you've gone without singing or playing?
Probably two or three days when I had laryngitis a couple times. No, every day I pick up a guitar or go to the piano and sing something. I think it's a best thing a singer can do.
Just
keep the chops happening.
We've got a little bit of tape here from, we don't even know what year it is. It's black and white.
Wow.
From the Wayne and Schuster Show. Let's take a little look.
Wow. That would be 69 or 70. That cleft, Bert.
I guess you were a little younger then, were you?
Oh, yeah. That's great footage. I don't think I even have that. That's really incredible.
We'll lend it to you
afterwards. Thank you. Just for my own
use. When you hear those songs laughing, I read that it actually took you guys 10 minutes to write that song.
Well, maybe 20.
Maybe 20.
That one was quick. That one was really quick. We were waiting for the ferry to go from Vancouver to Vancouver Island. We were doing a show in Victoria, and we were all sitting on our old highway bus. Yeah. And we went, after the show in Vancouver, we went right to the ferry terminal, stayed there all night till the 6 a.m. ferry for Victoria, and Randy picked up an acoustic guitar and started playing the chords, and I started singing, and I know it was well less than half an hour before the song was done. So it was maybe 20, 25 minutes, but that's still a very well-spent 20 minutes.
How does that work? How does that happen? Why do some songs take 3 years and some songs 20 minutes?
Actually, in my case, it's never taken very long.
Yeah.
I've never spent more than about an hour or an hour and a half writing a song ever. I figure if it's not flowing that quickly, then scrap
go
it and move
else.
On to something else. And because of that, it's never been a process with me that's been belabored at all. It's always been something enjoyable. I think the muses visit you from time to time. You have to realize when that's happening, work with the moment, capture the moment, get the machines running, get it on tape, and move on to something else.
When the muses, as you say, come to visit, who are they and what form? Is it sparked by some experience, or is it completely random?
You know, I've been asked so many times over the decades, how do I write songs? What is the process? And I'm still unable really
damned
to explain
if you know.
I really don't know. I do know that sometimes I will sit down and let my hands go freely to different chords, not looking at where they are, and I'll think about a certain lyrical theme and just kind of expound upon that, letting my hands go where they will. And if the machines are running, usually within 15 or 20 minutes, if the song isn't finished, at least there's a good portion of something there, for something from which to draw, you know. I can't explain it. And I've never understood these songwriters who get together at 10 in the morning till 5 in the afternoon, and it's 10 a.m. Is it time to be brilliant
it's
now?
It's time to write now.
I've never subscribed to that method, and I've never understood that method. I will jump out of bed sometimes at 4 a.m. and run to the piano with an idea, and by 5 in the morning there's something on tape that's worth listening to. But I'm not a slave to the writing process. You know, I wait till I'm inspired.
Is it easier to do that solo, or when you and Randy Bachman were working together, did the spark help?
I liked working with Randy because we each brought each other half finished songs. We would bring pieces to each other, and 98 times out of 100 they would mesh very, very well. So the process was always a pleasure with Randy, and then later with Kurt Winter, who sadly left us a year and a half ago now. But I had the same type of experience in chemistry with Kurt. We would bring each other pieces, whether it would be a guitar riff over which I could sing, or a chord progression that I would somehow have some prose or poetry that would fit with that. I've been lucky because I've been blessed with two or three really good partners during the years. But solo, it's not that much different solo.
To go and write. The reunion this past summer, I mean, you've gotten together on occasion, but this was such a big deal. There must have been an awful lot of trepidation.
I was very nervous just before the show. Someone, about 20 minutes before we went on for the big finale that Sunday night, someone came and said, "Now, there are about 300 million watching this on television."
But no pressure.
Good Lord, 2% of the human species, you know, is tuned into this. I was very nervous, but... really and truly, it was fun. We all felt 19 again. You know, I wanted it to be good. I wanted to hit my notes the way I did on the record. And, you know, all the old nicknames started resurfacing, all the old shenanigans, all the old group jokes and stuff. And it was fun.
But can you go back again?
Well, one thing you can't do is make it 1970 again. You can get guys together and they can play the songs and they can push people's buttons historically and memory-wise. You can't make it 1970 again. That's one thing you can't do. So time has passed. We all look a bit different. Fortunately, we didn't sound that much different from the records. And that's, I think, what was captured on that. Plus, they filmed the entire week of rehearsals and backstage patter and the jokes and the guffawing. And I'd strap on the guitar for no time. I'd go into an old Moby Grape song, an old Cream song from the 60s, and the guys would jump in. And that was fun. That was the magic. That special now is being edited as we speak for a documentary, which probably will show before Christmas sometime. And that, to me, will be the big payoff.
Okay,
you know?
But did you really kiss and make up, or did you just get together for a reunion performance?
There really was not that much for which to make up. This has been blown way out of proportion by the journalistic world. You know, we've had our differences, but no more so than any other successful band. I mean, I remember when the Beatles broke up, you were hearing about the, you know, people hating Yoko for years and years later, and people talking about Paul's terrible business attitudes and the hatred between the boys for years and years. And I asked Ringo about this personally.
Yeah.
When I toured with the Ringo band in 92, we went all over the world, and he said, "No, it's all blown way out of proportion." The same thing with the Guess Who.
You have always, I don't know if you still do, kept a diary.
Yes.
Do you?
Still do. And it's much easier now with a laptop computer.
What was the entry that night?
I just remember thanking the gods for letting me hit my notes, because people told me I hadn't sung that well in years.
Yeah.
I wanted to get a really great night's sleep the night before and be as calm as I could possibly be, you know. And I remember going on stage, and when it was over, and you know, my mother was there, and a lot of my old school friends were there, and countless fans had come from, people came from as far as Texas to see us live again,
amazing.
In case it would be the last time. People came from Chicago.
But it might not be.
People flew in from Montreal, they flew from Vancouver and Toronto, and it was so exciting to see that love, you know, that incredible energy directed toward the four of us. And I just remember thanking the luck gods, you know, and thanking the divas and the muses and Buddha and the Force, whatever name you want to attach to it. I just remember being so thankful at how well it went. And I also wrote that night, I don't think this will be the last time.
Yeah. That is interesting. We'll talk about that. And we're going to hear Burton Cummings play live for us right here in the studio in just a few moments. But as we go to this break, American Woman, your biggest single hit.
Yes.
Ever.
Yes.
Now big again, because Lenny Kravitz is doing it.
Almost bigger this time, ironically, almost bigger than ours was, because Lenny is such a huge star, and with the advent of video, it has changed the market so much. This record is all over the world, in Germany, and France, and Holland, and good Lord.
Well, let's listen to the guests who do it.
Try every night.
Cummings, These Eyes, about 1969. I can't imagine a contemporary of ours not having fallen in love or out of love listening to that song. It's hurting music.
It's, you know, as I think of that song retrospectively now, it's a fairly mature song for the age at which Randy and I were when we wrote it. It was hypothetical, of course. I was 20 and Randy was about 23 when we wrote it. So we hadn't lived long enough to have those experiences that the song describes, you know, personally, and yet it was all hypothetical writing, but it has stood up very well. It really has.
A
it was
lot
also
of the
covered
lyrics.
By
yeah.
Was covered by Junior Walker and the All-Stars on Motown, and they had a top 20 hit with it, and it's been done by at least 15 other artists.
That was 1969. By 1970, the Guess Who had sold more records than the rest of the Canadian music industry put together.
Mm-hmm.
And this was before the Canadian content rule.
I think if there's a bit of a legacy other than musical that the Guess Who has left behind, I think we were instrumental in, and I've said this on stage, not meaning to sound arrogant, but I think we were instrumental in laying some foundational blocks for the Canadian industry. And nowadays it's certainly healthy with Shania and Alanis and Brian and Celine. And I mean,
but people thought you were a British group for a while and you got better play then.
Well,
they found out you were from Winnipeg.
That was even before I was in the Guess Who.
Yeah.
They released a record called Shaken All Over, which was a fairly big hit. And it was in the height of the British invasion, 1965, when everything was Beatles, Stones, Kink, Zombies, Dave Clark Five. And so that the record label in New York, Scepter Records, decided to just put it out. It said, Shaken All Over, Guess Who, with a question mark. And nothing else. No information imparted.
And everybody thought, oh, this
People
is a new
thought,
British
thought, oh, it's a new British band, probably from London, might even be the Beatles under a fake name. And It became a huge hit, and because of that record, they changed their name to The Guess Who.
Yeah. The Guess Who and Burton Cummings, your material, a lot of your early material, has just been digitally remastered.
Yes.
And put out on a whole new series of CDs.
My first,
that must be great.
My first four solo albums have all come out simultaneously on CD, on Sony. Original artwork has been scanned. They allowed me to write liner notes for each of the booklets. There are two bonus tracks on each one, and until this morning, actually until the very day as you and I are sitting here, about 3 hours ago, for the first time in my life, I held these
you
in
held
my hand on CD,
in
and
your
this
hand.
Is just a thrill for me.
Yeah.
I'm so happy that the people at Sony have finally come through and done this.
I mean, it sounds better.
Oh, this sounds wonderful. Yeah. I also had the luxury of supervising the digital transfers down in Hollywood at a place called DigiPrep, with the legendary Bill Inglot, who's the king of digital transferring, and I must say that the stuff has never sounded this good, so I'm just thrilled to see these sitting here on your table in CD form. I'm absolutely thrilled.
You're back, you're here. Now, CDs aside, we want the real thing.
The real thing?
We want the real thing.
Over there at a keyboard?
At a keyboard. What are you going to do? Like, is there a favorite song that you always...
Well, I'd like to do one of the ones that I think has stood up very well through the years. You know, when you've been around as long as I have, some of the early stuff comes back to haunt you and embarrass you, but this one is not one of those. I'll do a song called I'm Scared.
Oh, great. Okay. Well, what are the ones that embarrass you? Come on.
Well, you think I'm going to tell you?
Yeah, because then we'd go and
you
find
think
them.
I'm going to draw attention to those? No, Pamela, no. This one I do like, and I wrote this after a brief visit to the beautiful Cathedral of St. Thomas in downtown Manhattan, and it sounds like this.
Singing something about goodwill toward men and by to see St. Thomas on a cold and dreary New York afternoon. Something in the air was oh so rare. I don't know what it was, but I know that it's still right. Never been much on religion, but I showed up, just fell down on my knees. Living in confusion, searching for truth that I never found. I needed something I could really believe. Heavens on a dark and stormy winter afternoon. Something in the air was oh so rare. I'm not really sure what it was, but I know for sure that it's still right there. And I'm scared, just terrified. Never been much on religion, but I sure enough just fell down.
That's beautiful. You still love playing, don't you?
Yeah, I do. I feel comfortable behind a keyboard, actually. Mm-hmm. And I still like, I always told myself, you know, if I reached a point where I, God forbid, couldn't hit the notes, couldn't do justice to the records, that I would quit, you know. But this New Year's Eve will be my 52nd birthday, and I'm still hitting the notes, so I'm
keep
still
on going.
Doing it. Yeah, yeah.
Burton Cummings is our guest. We'll continue our conversation, and maybe he'll hit a couple of other notes for us, too, if we're very, very good. Burton Cummings on CD.
Oh, I like
digitally remastered. We've decided just to leave him at the piano because that's where he belongs, but just a couple of questions. You said a few moments ago that when you were writing in your diary about the reunion, you sort of got the sense that it might not be the last.
I think now we will do some shows. There's an offer to go to Japan. There are many, many offers to go to America, possibly even Australia again. I think before we're too old, you know, before we're too tired, before anything changes in the glow of what has happened at Pan Am, I think we should take the chance, seize the moment and do this, you know. And we're all very up for it. As far as I know, the other three guys are very, very into this. And it was just fun. I mean, that's the simplest way. It sounds kind of corny to say it that simply, but it was fun. We all felt 19 again. There is a certain chemistry that happens when Jimmy and Randy and Gary are playing. I sing better, or differently anyway. Yeah. And Randy always says he plays better when I'm singing with him, you know. So there's something that happens. Tinkerbell spreads her fairy dust over us when the four of us get together. And you know, in the light of the city of Winnipeg, it was very valid. Yeah. Because all four of us were born and raised in Winnipeg. We're all dyed-in-the-wool Winnipeggers.
It's still your home. I mean, you keep a house there.
You only get one hometown. Yeah. I have a house that I have kept there since 1990, and it's on the same block where I grew up as a little boy. The same trees I climbed are still there. There are even some neighbors that remember my grandmother and grandfather. It keeps me grounded when I go there, and I've spent more and more time in Winnipeg over the last few years.
But you're also an international rock star. Are you still living with the fame, the recognition, the no such thing as privacy?
It's a little better in Los Angeles because on every street corner there's some movie star or something, you know, and there are so many people. There are 13 million people in one place, so it's a little easier there to go unrecognized. Yeah. But I don't know. I liked L.A. better when I was younger. I have a feeling that I will probably move back to Canada full time sometime within the next few years. And I do enjoy being in Winnipeg. I've rekindled a lot of old friendships from school buddies, and my mother is still there, and a lot of my cousins, and I like it.
It becomes more important somehow, doesn't it?
I think as you get older, I think your roots mean more, you know. To me, certainly that's the case. And there's a comfort zone I have in Winnipeg whereby I have nothing left to prove to anyone.
You were even
myself.
Being a DJ all summer long on a radio station.
I've been on the radio in Winnipeg on KY58, a 50,000-watt clear channel station, playing music that encompasses from about 1954 to 1977. Basically, it's an oldies station, a classic rock station.
Yeah. Oh, that's
and we've
great.
Been playing everything from Fats Domino and Gene Vincent right up to ELO. Okay. And it's wonderful because they've let me pick the music. They've given me free reign.
Oh, all right, let's pretend.
Tell the stories, you know.
Let's pretend that you get to pick the music right now as we say goodbye. Our thanks to Burton Cummings. And play us out, will you?
Play something. Well, I might
great
play something of my own, actually.
Play something of your own. Why don't you?
I might. Okay.
Thank you.